Father's Day this last June, my oldest son sent me a book through the mail. I'm not sure I would have picked it up normally to read it, but I'm finding it absolutely fascinating. It's a book by James Comey, recently published, called A Higher Loyalty. Comey served as head of the FBI under Obama and previously under Trump, and previously as the United States Deputy Attorney General in the administration of George Bush, the latter. And in it, he recalls the first time he sat in a room with the president, the vice president, the FBI director at that time, the National Security Advisor, and the Secretary of Homeland Security to discuss terrorism threats in the aftermath of 9/11. He writes, "In that moment, something hit me. It's just us. I always thought that in this place there would be somebody better. But it's just this group of people, including me, trying to figure stuff out. I didn't mean that as an insult to any of the participants who were talented people, but we were just people, ordinary people, in extraordinary roles, in challenging times. I'm not sure what I expected, but I met the top of the pyramid, and it was just us, which was both comforting and frightening. Suddenly, Bob Dylan was in my head singing, 'What looks large from a distance, close up, ain't never that big.'" As we will see in our Bible text this morning, there are times when we dismiss the miracles and even the very presence of God simply because they come to us in a familiar, ordinary face. And there are also times when we come alive to the realization that this is our time to make a difference. This is our time to save a life. This is our time to speak or act. Ordinary as we may be, maybe an ordinary life is exactly what it takes to do an extraordinary thing. So I invite you to turn in your Bibles to the sixth chapter of the Gospel of Mark, Mark chapter 6. You may remember, for those who were here last Sunday, we left off where Jesus was doing sort of a healing sandwich of a miracle. He is asked by a ruler of the synagogue to come to his house to pray for his daughter, 12-year-old daughter, who is dying. And on his way, he's interrupted by a woman who touches his cloak. And she has been troubled for 12 years by hemorrhaging, and she is instantly healed. And during the conversation that Jesus has with her, the announcement is made that he is too late, that the 12-year-old girl has died. He nevertheless continues on to the house where the ruler of the synagogue reaches out to the girl and raises her to life. And you can bet that word spread and spread quickly. And so we pick up the story now in chapter 6, verse 1. "So Jesus left that place and came to his hometown, and his disciples followed him. On the Sabbath, he began to teach in the synagogue, and many who heard him were astounded. They said, 'Where does this man get all this? What is this wisdom that has been given to him? What deeds of power are being done by his hands? Is not this the carpenter, the son of Mary, the brother of James and Joseph and Judas and Simon? And are not his sisters here with us?' And they took offense at him. Then Jesus said to them, 'Prophets are not without honor, except in their hometown and among their own kin and in their own house.' And he could do no power. Jesus could do no deed of power there, except that he laid his hands on a few sick people and cured them. And he was amazed at their unbelief. Then he went about among the villages teaching. He called the 12 and began to send them out two by two, and gave them authority over the unclean spirits. He ordered them to take nothing for their journey except a staff, no bread, no bag, no money in their belts, but to wear sandals and not to put on two tunics. He said to them, "Wherever you enter a house, stay there until you leave the place. And if any place will not welcome you and they refuse to hear you as you leave, shake off the dust that is on your feet as a testimony against them." So they went out and proclaimed that all should repent. They cast out many demons and anointed with oil many who were sick and cured them. The words of God for the people of God. Let us pray. God, as we seek to understand these words, we seek first of all to understand them in the context in which they were placed, but also to listen to their voice to us here in 2018, to discover the claim that you placed upon our life, to see the possibilities of what can be if we are willing to go forth. Amen. When I was 12 years old, I preached my first sermon at our hometown church. And mustering all of my years of wisdom and worldly experience, I spoke on the subject of Elijah and the prophets of Baal. And people were lenient and tolerant in their critique. In 2004, exactly 30 years later, I was finally asked to return. Probably it took that long for them to forget my first step. On the second occasion, I spoke on the subject of roots and wings, roots and wings, how a strong sense of identity gives us the freedom to soar into the winds of possibility, miracle, and grace. And as before, most were affirming, save one former neighbor who met me at the door and said, "Well, Steve, don't quit your day job." Apparently he didn't notice my biographical note that, that was my day job. I take comfort from the fact, though, that Jesus had a similar reception from his hometown, probably Nazareth. With his celebrity established, people know who he is. They've heard of his deeds of power. They've heard of the healings that have taken place, the deliverances, his preaching, his wisdom, the authority that he carries within the words that he shares and applying Torah to daily life. They've heard most likely about this incredible story of this 12-year-old girl who was raised from the dead. All of that has preceded him as he comes to the pulpit of the synagogue of his own hometown in Nazareth. And he begins to teach, and people are impressed with his knowledge and with his wisdom and with his reports of power. But then they start to remember who he is. Wait a minute. Isn't this the carpenter? The word in the Greek is tekton, which isn't even a master carpenter. Isn't this the carpenter, the son of Mary, whose brothers we know and sisters we know the mischief they've gotten themselves into. Isn't this one who is from our own hometown? How can he possibly have any real insights into matters of the spirit? And in their assumptions and their familiarity with Jesus, they dismiss that Jesus could possibly be a prophet, thus rejecting the word of God in their very midst. "Prophets are not without honor," Jesus replies, "except in their hometown and among their own kin and in their own house." And then Mark, the gospel writer, records a statement which I find to be among the saddest in the entire New Testament, and he writes, Jesus was unable to do any miracles there, except a few healings, because of their disbelief. Remember, this is Jesus Mark is talking about. Now I wonder how often we block miracles of God because we think we know all there is about those around us. Over the years, there have been folks in my congregations whom I have observed who have gifts for pastoral ministry or congregational ministry, and then when encouraged, some of them have pursued a sense of call and have gone on to do some pretty wonderful things. But in all honesty, there are others who also had a sense of call and gifts that I did not see, that I did not recognize, who nevertheless, in spite of me, answered the call and have done some pretty incredible things as well. The point is this: our assumptions about those closest to us sometimes prevent us from recognizing the God-given potential within. We seek not only to have faith in God, but to grow in our faith in one another and the things that we can do together. Well, Jesus is grieved by their lack of belief and trust in what he can do, but he doesn't linger on that. Instead, he goes out and he goes to the communities around and he begins to preach and to teach and to heal and to deliver and do all the things he had before. And because they don't know his connections to Mary and his brothers and sisters, because they don't know that he is from a carpenter's family, because they don't know that he hasn't been trained in Torah by professionals, because they don't remember the time when he gave his mom and dad the slip and stayed and loitered at the temple while they searched for 3 days trying to find him, they don't know any of that. And yet, they see God working through him, and they trust, and they believe, and miracles happen. They follow Jesus wherever he goes. And then Jesus does something completely unexpected. He multiplies himself. He gathers his disciples, his fishermen, non-seminary trained, muggle-like, ordinary disciples, and he deploys them in mission, two by two. He gives them no seminar, no how-to book on how to do it, no ministry for dummies book, no food or bags or extra clothes, no reservations made in advance, and get this, no money at all. And he sends them in pairs with sandals and a staff. They are ordinary folk called to do an extraordinary thing in a challenging time. What's the result? Well, they go and they preach and they teach that people should repent of their sin and turn to God. And they begin to deliver people of the demons that have kept them bound. They begin to reach out and to anoint people with oil so that they are healed from their illnesses and diseases. And miracles of grace and power happen in the communities to which they go. Communities that were visited not by Jesus, but by ordinary folk who simply went forth in his name. The youths and the meeks who answered the call. And the contrast could not be more obvious. In one place, Nazareth, lack of faith prevents even Jesus himself from doing miracles of power. In other places, active faith enables his ordinary followers to do those miracles of power and to plant a kingdom ethic in revival wherever they go. In the Bible text, we see Jesus' words of prophecy come true from John chapter 14, verse 12. Verily, truly, I tell you, the one who believes in me will also do the works that I do, and in fact, will do greater works than these, because I am going to the Father. Don't ever fall into the trap of thinking that you are too ordinary to do God's work. What you deem no special talent is the very gift that God will use to build God's kingdom. The disciples went forth with nothing greater than their staff and their sandals and the encouragement of Jesus. But they did go forth, and look what happened. Miracles of grace abounding wherever they went. In the words of one preacher, God doesn't call the equipped. God equips the called. Put another way, in that moment, something hit me. It's just us. I always thought that in this place there would be somebody better. But it's just this group of people, including me, trying to figure stuff out. And I didn't mean that as an insult to any of the participants who were talented people, but we were just people, ordinary people, in extraordinary roles, in challenging times. I'm not sure what I expected, but I had met the top of the pyramid, and it was just us, which was both comforting and frightening. Suddenly, Bob Dylan was in my head singing, "What looks large from a distance, close up, ain't never that big. By the grace of God, let's go forward." Let us pray. God, sometimes we underestimate the incredible potential that exists in those around us. And sometimes, quite honestly, we underestimate the incredible and extraordinary potential that exists within our own ordinary self. You are looking for those who are willing to go forth. You are looking for ordinary lives, and through them you can do extraordinary things. Help us to have the courage to go. Help us to be willing to put our life in the hands of another. Help us to be willing to touch their life and engage their problems and provide the encouragement that we uniquely can to help them find their next step in the road to eternal grace. We give you thanks for the journey. I'd like to invite our ushers to come forward so that we might gather our morning time.